everyone has settled down well. And I welcome you all to the Prasthi Vichar Joke Festival. Tonight we embark on a captivating journey through time, delving into the legendary epic of Mahabharata and the enigmatic world of medieval history. So let's welcome our esteemed guests. First, I would like to welcome Ms. Amy Ganatra, an IIMA alumna who has over 15 years of global business strategy experience. A certified yoga instructor and student of Sanskrit, she's authored 3 books, including Mahabharata Unraveled, aiming to present the epics in their original form and making them accessible to all. Next, I would like to welcome Professor Umesh Ashok Kavath, an expert in medieval Indian and early modern history. He hails at JNU New Delhi, former member secretary of the Indian Council of Historical Research. He specializes in the history of Deccan and Western India. He is actively engaged in promoting advanced research on Deccan history in universities across Europe. Let's give them a warm round of applause. Thank you so much. Finally, I would like to introduce myself. I am Ritika Venkat. I am a counseling psychologist and I work with soul wellness. I finished my education from Ambedkar University. And with my thoughts, knowledge on Mahabharata and the medieval history, I would definitely like to know more. And I will act as the moderator today.
Okay, so before we actually begin, I would like to welcome. It's an honor and privilege to be sitting here next. So I would like to start with my questions, right? Okay. So both of you have explored different aspects and different periods of history. I mean, you talk about Mahabharata, and Umesh, you talk about the medieval history. How do you perceive that these historical narratives intersect with each other, and how do you bring about a broader insight in front of it? Please, anybody can take it up.
So when I talk about, first of all, thank you everybody for, thank you, Prasthi Vichar Manch, for having me and all of you for sitting here at like 7 p.m. on Friday when you could have done much more. So thank you for coming. I don't look at history from a narrative perspective, though today history has become a playground of narrative warfare. We need to know history to know ourselves, going back as far as possible, right? Today, globally, we've been talking about decolonization, decoloniality. What is decoloniality? It's like going back to the roots. Which roots? This is where the history comes into play, right? Also, because I talk about Mahabharata and Ramayana essentially, I talk about how Itihas was perceived in other countries. Itihas, of course, is a documentation of the past. If you go back to the originals, jo Vedras ne likha hai aur Valmiki ne likha hai, it has a lot of documentation of the past, of the way the geography was at that time, the way the society was at that time. But the purpose was little more than that. ज्यादा व्यापक था इतिहास का स्कोप एट दैट टाइम. सो व्हाट वाज द स्कोप? आई से दिस एवरीवेयर एंड आई लव टू कोट दैट श्लोक. सो वी से इतिहास, द मीनिंग इज इतिहास, सो इट वाज ऐसा हुआ था. एंड देयर इज अ डेफिनेशन टू इतिहास, इट सेज धर्म अर्थ काम मोक्षाणा उपदेशक समन्वित पूर्ववृत्त कथायुक्त इतिहास प्रचक्षते पूर्ववृत्त. सो इन अवर परंपरा देयर इज एब्सोल्युटली नो क्वेश्चन about whether Mahabharata and Ramayana are history or just a story. They are history, for parampara, because it is called itihas. And Purvavrutta definitely happened in the past. Kathayukta, it is told to us in a katha format. Why? And that is why it has certain metaphors. But it has a udesha. The udesha is what now we call narrative. But the larger udesha, the larger goal is for us to learn from the lives of our ancestors. Good, bad, everything. What should we do? How to lead our lives? What should we not do, right? And then here is the intersection of the social structure, of the philosophy, of dharma, of religion, all of this. So that's how I perceive itihas. Now, does it, talking about Umesh's work, right? going to medieval history. Learning history of time period also allows us to see how the society would have evolved. And what do we see of it today? But we need to know history for what it is rather than just the story of narrative. That's how I see it. Thank you.
Thank you, Pragati Pichar, and also thank you, Amila Natharaji. You are not a person of history, but even after that, you well into the prospects of history and with a very historical sense. So, thank you. You are welcome in the realm of history with historians as well.
This means a lot to me when you're coming from
here.
Thank you.
And let me tell you, we really don't know when the history of India became a legend and the legend became a myth. So what we talk about these narratives and meta-narratives in Indian history, the Indian history has been turned into a myth. So now it is a time for us to revisit these constructed myths, deconstruct them, understand their legendary values, and then understand what Amiji said, that it's not history but it is itihas. So this itihas and history. History is a discipline which was developed by the Europeans somewhere in the 19th century. And we have this classic model of scientific history which comes from Nehru and Ramke, where they say, no document, no history. But the words which were being used by Ramke, exactly in German language, is Wissenschaft. So he was not talking about any scientific method, but it was not scientific, it was actually scholarship on which he was trying to, put his hands on. But there is a long debate which goes on in Europe about scientific history and scholarship in history. But in the Indian sense, itihas as a tradition, how we perceive itihas. So in this itihas, we have, the first thing which we have is darshan. The second thing which we have is gyan. And the third thing which we have is vidya. Now what are these three things? This is the whole idea of history, how it should be perceived. The first is darshan, that is viewpoint, a point of view which has been brought forth. There is a discussion on this point of view, the darshan. And whatever has been created through that is gyan, knowledge. Knowledge has been created. So it is manufactured. And episteme, a theory of knowledge, has been taken on. And this theory of knowledge, episteme, that is, through the science of interpretation of that, is being created into vidya. Vidya is, in the sense, that is pedagogy. Pedagogy which is being used by teachers to tell what history is about and how the Indian civilization actually flourished, what are the contours of influence and confluence of the Indian civilization. But Indian civilization, in the sense, right from the ancient times to the medieval times, has been ridiculed a lot. It has been pushed back because it was an advanced civilization. And all these happened exactly in this very medieval era of India. And hence this medieval era of India is not a dark age like the European civilization, the European history. They themselves declare to be a dark civilization. But in the Indian sense, it is not a dark civilization. Let me just tell you that we were giving out 24% share in the world economy. Now people will ridicule, they will say, well, they said that this 24% of share was there of India in the world economy in the medieval times. But it's not only a story of Sonic Chidiya in the ancient times, it was very much in the medieval times. And then you can see this whole idea going down to 0.1%. by the coming of the 18th and 19th century, and a different kind of aura of discussions has been created in front of us in the form of debates, colonial debates. And before the colonial debates, we all have another kind of an historiography which is being created, which actually dismantles Indian history through the medieval period only by understanding what happened from the 13th to the 18th century. Now let me talk only about the 18th century India. The Marathas are ruling from Katak to Attak. The history of India is nothing but the history of the Marathas. But nowhere in the 18th century debate of the Oxford University Press series this has been dismissed anywhere. They don't accept the whole idea of Marathas being the formidable power in India. When you visit all these Dutch East India Company records, the Portuguese East India Company records, or the French East India Company records, where they are clearly, they themselves are saying that the Marathas are the formidable power in India in the 17th and the 18th century. And by the time the British take over India, the first thing which they say is that now as we have taken over the Marathas, we are the true masters of the Indian subcontinent. So we need to revisit all these things. Maybe we have some more questions and then we can get along.
Yeah, wonderful. Thank you so much. Your answer actually reminds me very much of this speech Mr. Shashi Tharoor gave at the Oxford University 6-7 years back, when he was talking about, you know, how so much of the world GDP force came from India, and now, like, after all the invasion and the British rule, it just came down to 0 point something. So, you know, we talk about history and we talk about a lot of different things, and you know, when they trickle down, a lot of things, they sort of became obsolete in, let's say, present time. So how do you think that, you know, talking about Mahabharata and talking about the medieval history, how do you think it is still relevant for, let's say, the people who are sitting here, me and like people from our generation and the younger generation? How do you bring those times to the contemporary times and sort of match the narrative?
So, one question always asked is this, that why are Mahabharata and Ramayana relevant, right? On the other hand, when we talk about the society, let's see some incident, very unfortunate incident, jahan kisi stri ke saath dushkarma hota hai. What is the immediate reaction of a lot of these people who come out with the cards? Ye to Bharatiya Sanskriti hi aisi hai, okay? And they go back to Mahabharata, they go back to Ramayana, and they say, your samaj has always been Sri Krishna samaj, right? And we are asking, what is the relevance of Ramayana and Mahabharata? Well, even today, they go back all the way to get those examples, right? So one is that, about how are we presenting our past to create a narrative today, trying to show us that there was nothing that we had that was good, rather everything that we had was bad, and all we got was because of the colonial masters who came. Exactly what Sir said. Now, Sir said something very interesting. Forget Oxford University Press. Why did we not talk about the Maratha Kingdom after we became independent? What were our own historians doing at that point, right? Bahar wala ko to chhod do. Unko to apna interest hai. But what about us? Same thing goes back for Mahabharata and Ramayana as well. If those examples are going to tell us how bad we were, and hence people disassociate themselves from their own roots. What happens when you disassociate from your own roots? You become a ready target for any kind of brainwashing. I'll give you a real life example from US. There is a family which was a very rooted family. Bachpan se bachon ko dharm ke baare mein bata raha hai, sikha raha hai, all that. They go to university, take up Indic history. The girls come back and they say, we are not going to celebrate Ram Navami. Because Sri Ram, we cannot relate with him. See what he did to his wife. Now, what is happening today is, we as parents don't have answers to the questions which the youngsters are asking, right? Why not? Because in after independence, for whatever reason, we started thinking this itihas is not at all relevant. Hence, we did not study, or whatever we studied was only based on kahi se bhi baatein. Also, because we made our itihas mythology, anybody who would write about itihas would say, oh, this person's perspective, this is that person's perspective. Koi Karna ke perspective se likh raha hai, koi Draupadi ke perspective se likh raha hai. And again, this justified is, arre apne liye to har time likhte rehte hain. So everything goes under the name of Mahabharata Ramayana. Aapko kisne bataya Draupadi ka kya perspective tha? आपको किसने बताया कर्ण का क्या पर्सपेक्टिव था? ये आपका पर्सपेक्टिव है. तो एक तो आप अपने आप को वेदव्यास और वाल्मीकि बना चुके, है ना? एंड देन यू आर प्रेजेंटिंग योर फिक्शन वर्क एज इतिहास. आई थिंक दैट इज जस्ट डिसऑनेस्ट. वी हैव ऑलवेज हैड फ्रीडम, क्रिएटिव फ्रीडम, बट इट वॉज ऑलवेज यूज्ड वेरी यूज्ड ऑनेस्टली. यू से दिस इज my imagination. Now, you say this is my work, why do you want to justify it to pass it off as itihas? So I think if we understand as itihas for what it is, we don't even need to contemporize it. Let me give you one very simple example. Because I started with Sri Dvesh. I've spoken about it a lot of times, but if there are new audience here, I'd love to speak about it. Hum jab bhi Draupadi ki baat karte hain, what is the incident that comes to your mind? What do you see Draupadi as? Vastaharan? Anybody else? It's usually that Vastaharan hai, ya Gusta hai, ya Andhe ka putra Andha hai, right? Now, in Vedvyas Jee's Mahabharat, and in any value script of Vedvyas Jee's Mahabharat, Andhe ka putra Andha to hai hi nahi. And you know what is a very interesting part which is never spoken about? Also, people who claim to write about feminist viewpoint and Draupadi, they also very nicely, happily ignore this part. There is a beautiful samvad of Draupadi and Satyabhama in Mahabharata where Draupadi talks about her role as the queen of Indraprastha. Now, I can speak on this for another half an hour, so I'll not go into the details, but I think you guys should check it out. The Draupadi Satyabhama samvad I have covered in my book Mahabharata and Ravid, first part of it as well, where she is basically saying, I was the CFO CEO of that kingdom because nobody had the transparency of the treasury which I had. This is a lady, this is a queen whose day the husbands, the kings, everybody trusted me with the finances, not only of the household but of the kingdom. Why aren't we told about this? If this happens, we will not have to look outside for having our ideas. We will look at role models from within. We will learn to be, we will know what it is, what it is to be a Bhartiya, and it also impacts our policy decisions, right? You all have heard S. Jayashankar talk about why is Bharat important and everything, and what does he go back to? He always goes back to these stories from our history about how should a good ambassador be. There's so much to learn. I think more than anything, it is our responsibility to ensure this knowledge is preserved and passed on.
Coming to the medieval, the whole aspect of understanding Ramayana, Mahabharata and the ethics which are being proposed through Ramayana and Mahabharata, there are no canvas, it enlarges. What we don't see as medieval Indian history is from what is happening from the 8th to the 14th century. We are very much interested in understanding medieval Indian history only by the 13th, 14th century to the 17th, 18th century. But this phase, 8th to 14th century, is a very important phase because one of the most beautiful structures built across the world is Kailash, the Temple of Kailash, which is a singular monolithic structure which is built. And Mahabharata as well as Ramayana, they come up in written forms, various written forms, and they get popularized through folk. Because it is not only Sanskrit versions which come down in the 8th to the 14th century. There is a lot of vernacular, Prakrits are shaping themselves. Come down to understand the Hoysalaru, or the Yadavaru, or the Kaktiyaru, Kannada, Marathi, Telugu, go down into Kerala. You see there are various formats of propositions which have been done for Mahabharata, for Ramayana. They have been performed differently in different perspectives. The plots are been rewritten to understand the daily meanings of life, community life, and various problems within the life are being attached to the various aspects of the lives of various characters in Mahabharata and Ramayana, because this is also a phase. You can see that there are many famines, natural disasters, droughts which are taking place. But India is not shattered with this. There are dynasties within the 8th to the 14th century, coming up to the 17th century, which has outlived for 700 years, 800 years, 900 years. But what we try to understand medieval Indian history is only through the Eurocentric or the North-centric or the upper Gangetic belt view of understanding Indian history. You don't understand Indian history of what is happening from the Narmada to the Kaveri. For many of us, Deccan is Dakshin. Deccan is not Dakshin. Dakshinapath is a different identity, a cultural identity. Deccan is a larger Deccan is a cultural identity which encompasses this whole land between Narmada to the Kaveri. And this has been the hub of the world. Deccan was the world between the 8th to the 14th century. There is no single person coming from any country within the world who is there in Deccan. It is a melting pot of various cultures, of multicultural. But people don't want to understand this. They just want to understand what happened is that men of letters came into India only from the 14th century. Even before coming of Islam into India, there was an Abyssinian presence in India and they interacted a lot with the Indian people, and that happened in Deccan. Most of the governors who were taken in charge of all the major positions, prominent positions within the 14th to the 18th century are these Abyssinian governors. But we don't want to understand how India interacted with South Africa. Trade or India was been discovered by Vasco da Gama. How can Vasco da Gama discover India? Well, earlier the Satavahanas were having trade relations with the world, and the whole idea of Ramayana and Mahabharata has been going across the seas. But we are not trying to trace them through the vernaculars. The problem is that we are trying to understand Indian history either in two languages. One, Sanskrit, the other is Persian. And then we come into understanding the language in which I am trying to talk over here, because I have been handicapped. I cannot speak my mother tongue properly. I cannot speak my Rajabhasha properly because I was being sent to an English school. I was being trained in a colonial kind of an, the training went on again and again that I should speak in English, I should write in English. I can only, you know, be a scholar if I write in English and I have discourses. But then what happens to the Indian language? When I go to France, the French are not ready to talk with me. When I am in the interiors of France, when I am at Aix-Provence, at Marseille, they will not talk to me because my major work is on French-Maratha relations. So I have to interact with them within their language. I have to understand them through their language, because they say that if you speak our language, you will be able to understand properly. So if you remove Deccan from Indian history, this whole part of Deccan, if you remove this, means you are removing something as French history and German history from the European history. So you should not. You have to understand, have a proper understanding of Deccan and how these various, because the whole idea of Yantra, Tantra and Mantra is not a very spiritual or religious kind of thing. Yantra, if I give an example of temple, you go into the temple, any temple, there is a yantra of that temple. The yantra means how that temple has been constructed. What is the architectural format of that? So, usi hisab se, it is in the same way that the temple is being constructed. That is yantra. Tantra is the technology which went on in constructing that whole temple. That is tantra. And mantra are the equational formats, are the theories which have been propounded. So they are not mantras only to recite ki usse kuch aap mein jadui shakti aa jayegi ya aapko bahut acha lagega, you feel spiritual. It's not of that kind. Okay, these are equations. If you go and read all these Indian Sanskrit texts, or if you go and read the vernacular texts, you will get different kind of knowledge bases. All the, are we aware that there were 1300 languages in India? And all these people were trying to write and express their thoughts through all these languages. There are Prakrits of so many kinds. You have Shoreseni, you have Maghi, you have Maharashtri, you have Pisachi. But we hardly understand this language. We don't want to revisit our students and people. They don't want to read Hindi books or Marathi books or Tamil books. People are not interested to read. They will not pick up those books and give it to their sons and daughters that you please read this. Ram and Shivaji, they were not talking in English. It's very important for us. We are understanding Rama, Krishna, all these Dashavatars in English. We are trying to, you know, construct.
There are no parallel words to understand what they are saying, what they mean to us. Okay? So it is not a spiritual and religious affair, it is a very, very scientific affair where we have to, you know, well into the scholarship. That's what I mean.
One thing Ms. Umeji hinted to, and I'd love to know what do you know about it? Unhone Vasudev Gaon ka naam liya. Do you know how did he reach India? Do you know how? No, he was actually brought to India by a trader, a Gujarati trader, a Muslim Gujarati trader who was in Africa. Matlab, he already had those traditions. The route was known. He was guided to Bharat by a Bharatiya. And we say, in our history, we learn Vasco da Gama discovered India. Why did he start off to begin with? We heard this other guy reached US, huh? Why did they call them Indians? Columbus reached US. Why did he call them Indians? So they were trying to go to this place which they called India, right? If it did not exist, or as Askar today say, no, there was nothing like India, Britishers made India. Then what was East India Company? If the Britishers had made it, right? That is why knowing history matters.
That's wonderful to hear. So my next question would be that both of your work, they sort of bring a new perspective into things. They shed light on lesser known parts of the history. How do you sort of strike a balance between, you know, not offending or still respecting the myths or the interpretations or the perspectives which are already present and popular?
Yeah, I think this is more relevant for me, especially because Mahabharat Ramayana to sab chalta hai, that is what they say. So the question gets tricky when I'm asked this question with regards to certain punarkathans of Ramayana, especially. Mahabharat, we don't have that much of an issue, but Ramayana. They say, Acha Bhan, you say talk about Valmiki Ramayana, then what about Ramcharitmanas? The more well-known is Ramcharitmanas. And if somebody claims that agar aaj Ram Chetana hai, to wo manas ki karan hai, he will not be wrong. Similarly, there is a punarkathan of Ramayana, especially in every bhasha. There is Kamba Ramayana, there is a Telugu version, there is Kritivas Ramayana in Bengali, right? Then how do we make sense of all this? It's actually not so difficult. All these authors, all the kavis, they all agree on this fact that Adi Kavi is Valmiki Ji. There is absolutely no contention on that. Which means, if we have to think, if we have to take an ethnographic value of an image, okay? And there is a difference between what we find and what is the available Valmiki Ramayana today versus something, whatever event is mentioned in something else. If it's the same event, we go back to Valmiki Ramayana from an ethnographic perspective. But as far as Bhakti is concerned, right? As far as Sahitya is concerned, as far as bhav is concerned, there cannot be any betting on that. Wo to jiska jo bhav hai, that should be freely expressed and that should be accepted as well, right? So I will never say ki nahi nahi manas nahi hona chahiye. Nahi, manas has done something which was needed for that day and still doing it, right? So all these versions matter, they have their own place. Just we need to know what they are. However, I will still I'll still put a caveat to that. All those punarkathans had the right bhav, most of those. Yeah? Even if like thoda idhar udhar hai, to alag baat hai, but bhav sabka wahi hai. But today, if an author stands up and says, according to my perspective, I am going to get a subaltern perspective, and Ramayana is about a war of Aryan and Dravidian, then can we just accept it? No, we cannot. Because one, this is a divisive discourse thrown in with an agenda and propaganda. Only then that person will really say, I'll tell you why. Because Arya is mentioned in Valmiki Ramayana. Ravan is also called Arya. Okay? Ravan is also called Arya. Vali is called Arya. Sugriva is called Arya. Kaikeyi is called Arya. And those who are trying to run away from the battlefield are called Anarya. Kaikeyi is also called Anarya for the Vaishyas. Yeah, when she's asking for that completely unjustified demand. So, these are already used. So, how do you make this Aryan Dravidian bana diya? Also, who is the father of Ravan? Who is the father of Ravan? Vishvashrava ji. Vishvashrava is the son of Rishi Pulatya. They were Brahman. आपने इसको सबल्टर्न कहा से बना दिया, इतनी ऑनेस्टी तो होनी चाहिए ना. सो दोस काइंड ऑफ वर्जन अगर हम कहें दैट शुड ऑल्सो बी एक्सेप्टेड, देन आई विल पुट माय फुट डाउन एंड से नो इट इज गुड टू रीड एज अ फिक्शन बट नॉट एज एन एक्सेप्टेड वर्जन और इवन रीटेलिंग ऑफ रामायण. इट इज नॉट दैट.
I should thank this book. This book, it talks about whole of India. Medieval India retracting the past. We are trying to retract the past. And I am thankful to all my co-authors who are my students also. Ritika, Dolly, Aditya, and Anvit. And of course, Abhinav, Ravi Ranjan, Anandya, and many more of them who were a part of this whole exercise. Now, why we did this exercise for Medieval Indians and retracting the past? What does it talk about? It talks about the science, the technology, it talks about the warfare, it talks about various dynasties like the Ahom, the Gondwana, like what was happening in Kerala. It talks about Natya Shastra. And from Natya Shastra, how Nritya came, what were the meteors which were being constructed, what were the different parameters of languages which were being discussed widely and vividly by various scholars in the medieval world, right from Kashmir to Gujarat to Maharashtra to Andhra Pradesh. And how this whole idea of India, Jambudvipa, was being pursued by the medieval world. Now, we all say that Ashwamedh Yajna was being done in ancient times. Any idea if this yajna was being done again in medieval times? Huh? You have kings after kings who are engaging themselves in Ashwamedh Yajna, in Hiranyagarbha, in Agni Sotra. And there are many more which have been done. Why are they practicing all these different kinds of yajnas? What is it that they want to tell? The picture which has been given to us is that the princely states were fighting with themselves. The earlier dynasties were also responsible for each other's downfall. They were not at all, trying to empower their subjects. This is a completely wrong picture which has been given. So, where did these lakes come in? Where are these huge wells which were being created, built? These hard rock temples which came? These are certain questions. The jewelry which was being bought, zinc was being extracted in India in the medieval times. Dyeing industry of India, chins. You know what is chins? Hand printing jo banta tha. The same hand printing was being taken away by the industrial revolution and they started it to do with machine. जब hand printing से होता है and you wash it, आपके जो texture है ना fabric का वो और glow करता है, उसके colors और निहारते हैं हर एक wash के बाद. If it is hand print, if it is machine print, वो fade होता जाता है. So this cottage industries in India, the skills, the shawls, the pashmina shawls which were being woven by the people, the leather articles which were being made by the people in medieval India, the community living which was known as the gram bratak system, the common system, the jagmani system which was already over here has been sidetracked and we have been given mansardari system, permanent settlement act and what Akbar did to India, and Akbar had a court of Navaratna and there were only two gestures. One was Mahesh Das in the name of Birbal and one was Tenali. There were many more of them. There were many learned people. Birbal ji ko Gondwana se bahar bhaga diya gaya. And uske baad he got a job in Akbar's court. Gondwana was ruled by a mighty queen, Durghavati. You have mighty queens. Go to the 8th century, you have a queen Mahadevi and usko title diya hai Loka Mahadevi. She is concerned for her subjects, she thinks of her subjects. Umayya Devi, Go to Kerala, you will find what Mayavi is.
So all these kings, queens, small or bigger in the sense. There are two Maratha women who fought out for the Yadava dynasty very bravely. Their names are till today anonymous.
These are certain things of history which should be brought to our students in various formats. Kathakathan ke format mein laiye, history ke format mein laiye, sources ke format mein laiye. Whatever format you want to give, you give it.
But let them understand the values even of the bhakti movement.
Sant Gyaneshwar in the 12th century, he is writing Bhavad Deepika. Bhavad Deepika is the first critic on Bhagavad Gita in Maharashtra Prakrit. It comes into the people's language and people start to understand what is Bhagavad Gita. They understand the value of Bhagavata. Indian people are not interested only, history is not interested in only understanding the meaning. They are understanding the bhav, bhav artha, sirf artha nahi. The bhav and the artha together make a human and psycho history should be perceived through. The whole idea of history is what man has done to man himself. It limits only to the human species. The Indian ithihas tradition is not limiting man to understand what man has done to himself. It is rather trying to understand the Brahmand. The whole idea, Westerners are trying to understand history outwardly. The continental country and specifically India is trying to understand each and every aspect inwardly. जब तक आपको आप क्या है ये पता नहीं चलेगा, what you are meant, what is your purpose in the world. We live for ourselves, we do everything for ourselves. It is a material society, a very Marxist kind of an understanding of us is no collective material. No, it is an inward society. इसलिए ज्ञानेश्वर लिखते हैं, आता विश्वात में देवे ये नहीं वाक्यत ने तोषावे तोषो नहीं मत जावे बसाया. महाराष्ट्र प्राकृत में कह रहे हैं, इज टॉकिंग अबाउट ग्लोबल सिटीजनशिप, इज टॉकिंग अबाउट विश्वस्व धर्म सूर्य पाहो, इज टॉकिंग अबाउट अ सूर्य विच विल ग्लो फॉर विश्वस्व धर्म इन द 12th सेंचुरी. विश्वस्व धर्म, धर्म इज नॉट रिलीजन. रीड विवेकानंद, यू विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड द मीनिंग ऑफ व्हाट धर्म. यू हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड the whole idea which was been exposed by Krishna at Kurukshetra when he is talking about dharma. You have ridiculed it and you have brought down it only to religion. No. The dharma of Shivaji is the dharma of the people. His bodyguard is a Muslim. He has no problem with it. So we cannot divide, you know, the ancient Indian history as Hindu history, the medieval Indian history as a Muslim history, and the modern Indian history as very close to Christianity. No. Rather, we have to find out what are the influence and confluence. How Indian culture, we never said that Cholas discovered Southeast Asia. Do we say that? We rather accept the fact that they were expansionists. We accept the fact. You also accept the fact. They come over here and tell us that Shivaji is a mountain rat. Aurangzeb batate. Anybody who has frowned on Deccan, whether it may be Harsha, Harshavardhana, naam se joy hai, he lost his joy. When he had a fight with Pulkeshi or Narmada, he lost it. Then he lost his sleep. And then he lost his life. And the same thing happened to Aurangzeb. He lost his joy. He lost his sleep and then he lost his life. So hence the second book on Deccan in transition tells you why Deccan is a very important component. So please don't frown on Deccan history. Please accept Deccan history. Thank you.
And similarly, like, there's always something lost in translation, like, fate may गुड़ गुड़ होना, पेट में चूहे को कूदना इज डिफरेंट दैन आई एम हंग्री. इट्स ब्रिंग्स आउट अ डिफरेंट इमोशन आउट ऑफ द ऑडियंस. So, you know, like all of these histories, the aspects of history that you have explored, they are in fact in a different language. They are in a very personal language to all of us, maybe the 1500 languages that we will talk about. And so, and then there's English, the medium of translation, and the thing that, you know, to reach a larger audience, we have to translate. And even in academia, you know, they always suggest that, okay, first listen to the narrative in the language they are being spoken, and they understand the language, and then translate. And you do not do a literal translation, you do a meaningful translation in that. So how do you build this gap that, you know, what is being said and what has actually happened is also somehow being conveyed to the audience?
So I'll actually share my experience on this. When I had started, I had a lot of questions. One of them was, what does it mean to be a Hindu? What does it mean to be a Bharatiya? And there is this one book I recommend everybody wherever I go. There's a book called Being Different by Rajiv Malhotra. Rajiv, who's not read it, must read it. It is, for a lot of us, it has been a life-changing book. Life-changing in the sense that it has provoked us to ask these questions. So after that, I was dabbling with different kinds of books, and at that time I had not started learning Sanskrit formally. So I picked up a book on Nyaya Shastra. Yeah? And in Nyaya Shastra, unlike what the name says, it's a book on how to debate, how to do discussions, vaad vivaad kaise hota hai, different kinds of arguments, all that it talks about. And then suddenly, so I was reading an English translation by some foreign author, directly wahi pad rahi thi. So then it said that in this kind of argument, only people of the same caste will be allowed to argue. And I'm like, yeah, ye to sense nahi ban raha hai. Why would it be that people of the same caste are only can only argue? If the topic is generic, anybody should be able to argue, right? So I'm like, let me go back to the words. So I went back to the words and it had the word jati. Okay. Now, even without really knowing Sanskrit, I mean, I knew basic Sanskrit, school mein kiya tha and I liked it. But even without knowing, anybody who knows any Bharatiya bhasha will tell you that jati does not only mean jatast. Phalo ki jati, pero ki jati, phulo ki jati, right? Species is what jati also means. So then I took the Sanskrit and I tried to find a Hindi translation. The idea was actually very simple. Ki us kisam ke vaad vivaad mein, it's like doing an analogy. Let it be analogy of a similar kind of thing. Jaise we say, don't compare apples and oranges. This is exactly what he was trying to say, that compare oranges to oranges or compare fruits to fruits. So as a Mushroom, we also try to compare similar kinds of things rather than doing random comparison. About Socho, if somebody, if I had not really thought about going back to the Hindi or the Sanskrit, मेरे मन में तो वही रह जाता ना कि कास्ट से हर चीज में कास्ट से कुछ एल्बम उठाते थे, यही हम तो सोचेंगे है ना. So this incident actually pushed me to say, if I want to understand my text, I have to know basic Sanskrit. So today when I read a text, I do not even read the English translations. I read the Sanskrit with either Gujarati or Hindi. ठीक है, I'm not a Sanskrit expert. If पूरा का पूरा मैं translate कर दूँ, मुझे तो possible नहीं है. I understand. I can pick out where the issue is. But I try to read it in our fashion. So it could be either Gujarati or Hindi because I'm more comfortable with the two. And the Sanskrit. So Sanskrit is always there. So I think anybody who wants to talk about history of any particular region or Bharatiya history must definitely take the pains to learn basic Sanskrit and also refer to Bharatiya Anuvad of it in Bharatiya Bhasha. I think that really helps.
When it comes to language and the technique in which linguistic skills have to be handled, it becomes very imperative for us to actually know which languages are there which are spoken, which are languages which have become extinct, which are the languages which have grammar, and which are the languages which have only a script. So historically, we need to understand these various kinds of specimens of when I was doing my research, I started to, because I wanted to do something on Indo-European, and I was really fed up with having the same narrative given by the English East India Company and the British Crown about how India is and how you should understand the Marathas only through their perspective. So I thought that there has been a different perspective. There is a Dutch perspective. It's not only English Orientalism. There is a Dutch Orientalism, there is a Portuguese Orientalism, and there is a French Orientalism. I started to lay my hands on all these things. So I learned French, and then I went to France a couple of times. I worked nearly in all of those archives in France and at Lisbon, Toronto, and even at the Amsterdam in the archives of Harvard. And then I came to know that the whole idea, understanding of India through the perception of the Dutch, the French and the Portuguese is completely different. It's not the same as the English. The English are again and again reiterating that there is a French state within the Nizam's domain in India. So that is one thing. When Shivaji is talking about Hindi Swaraj, he has written an letter to his own cousin, he writes, Deccan for the Deccanese. He believes that Deccan remains only in the hands of the Deccan. Because there are contrast relationships between the Apatis and the northern Muslims. Deccanese Muslims or northern Muslims may काफी बुलंद है जिसको word आता है गरीब स्ट्रेंजर आप गरीब कहते हैं आप कहते हैं गरीबों की बस्ती दैट इज नॉट अ बस्ती ऑफ पुअर पीपल दैट इज अ बस्ती ऑफ स्ट्रेंजर्स एक्चुअली यू हैव टू ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड इवन यू ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड द पर्सन यू नीड टू अनलॉक थिंग्स जस्ट एज यू अनलॉक व्हेन यू गो टू अंडरस्टैंड द मीनिंग ऑफ लव इन द फ्यूडल सिस्टम ऑफ यूरोप व्हेन दे से आई लव यू माय किंग एंड ही नील्स डाउन ही किसेस द हैंड ऑफ द किंग लव का क्या अर्थ आज के डेट में लगाएंगे कि आई लव यू माई किंग वाई मेल इज सेइंग आई लव यू माई किंग टू अ मेल किंग द गुड इज नॉट नो इट इज देयर इन द सर्मन ऑफ जीसस क्राइस्ट नाम जीसस है जीसस बाद में बना आपको परिचित है ही इज जोशुआ इन द सेंस वो ये भी बनता है एंड देयर ही गिव्स अ सर्मन यू लव थy नेबर एज यू लव थy सेल्फ अगेन ही इज यूजिंग द वर्ड लव Here love is you be loyal to your neighbor as you are loyal to yourself. In the same way that person is taking an oath that oh my dear king I am going to be loyal to you. It is in the same sense you need to understand Indian history where there is no feudalism. But a construct of history is being created by framing up with various kinds of theories to give you feudalism. Ye feudal society thi, aise thi, no? It was a pastoral society, it was a nomadic society, and it went into an agrarian society. And you need to understand the agrarian frame of it, the language concept of content. Jisme hum kehte hain na, dhed gujri. When I'm talking to you right now, I'm using 2-3 languages. I did talk something in Marathi, something in Hindi, something in English. Mix kiya. Aise bahut log baithte hain. Chat karte ho, kab 3-4 bhashaon ka prayog karte hain. That is Dhed Gujri. And that Dhed Gujri is the bazaar language. It is not a gossip language. It is the local language of the people. You have to pick up from there what is the sentiment of the people. What is the sentiment of the community. And that is history. History is all about the hypolis. It is not only about the dynasty, the kings, queens and their tales. No. Rama's story is not about that he was to be a king. Rama's story is that he became a commoner. Altogether, when he leaves, he intermingles with different kind of people. He is going to different places. He is going to Chitrakoot. He is going to the Gandhararanya. Then he is visiting the town, the Andhra region, and then he is going into Sri Lanka. He visits so many people. He tries to understand. He is understanding their language, their format, their culture, their behaviors, and he is trying to give his own. In the similar way, Shivaji also goes to the Karnataka expedition. In the similar way, a contemporary of Akbar, Bahman Shah, Saraswati Pujak,
मानता है कि फर्स्ट आई हैव टू वर्शिप गणेश एंड देन ही प्रेजेस गोज ऑन प्रेजिंग सरस्वती. ही इज द पर्सन हु फर्स्ट फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम पेंट्स सरस्वती इन दैट ब्राइडल काइंड ऑफ थिंग वाइट सिटिंग ऑन अ गोल्डन थ्रोन एंड ही इज अ पर्सन हु इज सिंगिंग एवरी डे फॉर सरस्वती. फॉर हिम इट इज विद्यानगरी एंड देन इन हिस्ट्री द पर्पस इज राइट दैट ऑफ कोर्स ही इज नॉट अ जू, ऑफ कोर्स ही इज नॉट अ क्रिश्चियन एंड द फॉरमोस्ट थिंग दैट ही इज नॉट अ हिंदू. सो दे वांट टू पिन पॉइंट अगेन एंड अगेन दैट ही इज अ प्रैक्टिशनर ऑफ इस्लाम. When did Akbar go and ask for a recognition from the Caliph? He never asked. The Uzbeks were behind all these Chaktais, not Mughal, Chaktais, that they did not believe in Islam. And then here you have created a Mughal state was a theocratical state. Shivaji is writing a lengthy article. Chaziya pe likh raha hai Aurangzeb ko, ki bhai theek se aap, you know, understand Sharia. And be a pious Muslim. You are not a pious Muslim. You are not treating your subject equally. This is what he writes. And he is writing fine Persian. Shivaji's son, Sambhaji, is writing a book, Buddha Bhushan, in fine Sanskrit. Shivaji's father, Shahaji, and his uncle, Sarkoji, are being named in the traditions of Chandogodola, a Sufi tradition. So these people are practicing so many languages. My father said that, Umesh, my dear son, you are a citizen of Maharashtra state. I was a citizen of Bombay Presidency. And that's the reason I can speak 8 languages fluently and write 8 languages. Your problem is that you have been ridiculed to understand only Maharashtra. So this language component, you have to figure it out properly.
Add to the point which sir is making, let's see how much bhav the language has. Just one example. I've spoken about Bhargava in a lot of places, I'll avoid that. Raja, what did he say? Raja, the commoner Bhargava, that is the story. You know what the word means? Ranjita praja yena raja iti shabdate. Ranjita, because wo logon ko delight dilata hai. Because he is interested in the welfare of his people, he becomes a Raja. It is not a stature, it is a kartavya. The word itself has that meaning. And that is why knowing Bhasha is so important. Thank you.
Alright, thank you so much. Let's give them a huge round of applause. Now I'd like to welcome Mr. Kapil Gupta, who is the founder of Prakriti Vichar Literature Festival, to facilitate. I guess. This is a small token to all the panelists from NDP. Please let's keep the clapping coming.
Like you to correct me, and I am open for all kinds of suggestions. Thank you.